My name is Rick Rogers. I'm the district manager for the San Lorenzo Valley Water District. The purpose of this meeting is to give our customers an update on the district's response to the CZU lightning fire. This meeting is not a Brown Act meeting. It's a staff meeting. We are not going to be discussing future rebuilding or past construction of facilities at this time. There'll be ample time to discuss that moving forward. Definitely want to thank you all for attending. I want to welcome all of those back who's repopulated. As you know, 100% of the water district was evacuated. We may not have all the questions today due to the fact that, you know, you're going to ask, hopefully you'll ask a lot of questions, but we will get answers to your questions. This meeting is being recorded and will be posted on our website. Next slide. Our presenters today will be myself, and from the Water Systems and Operations will be James Furtado, our Director of Operations. Water Quality will be Nate Gillespie, your Water Treatment and System Supervisor. We also have our Finance and Customer Service, Director of Finance and Business Services, Stephanie Hill, and Outreach and Environmental Issues, Carly Blanchard, our Environmental Planner. Also, you'll see their email addresses on this slide. Please feel free to email, which is the best because our phones are ringing continuously with restoring the water system. So if you do have a question, please, our best form of communications right now would be email. Next slide. The CZU Lightning Complex Fire started Saturday, August 15th, and there was nearly 14,000 lightning strikes. There was more than 900 new wildfires across the state, which have now burned over 1.5 million acres. There has been statewide 8 fatalities and over 3,100 structures destroyed. Our fire, you can see the map, it started on 8/16. The cause was lightning. To date, 85,746 acres have burned. As of today, at our briefing, it was 48% contained as of today. 1,540 structures were destroyed. I do believe that's predominantly in Santa Cruz County, and there are some in San Mateo County. One fatality, and there is 2,224 personnel working on that fire. Like I earlier said, the entire San Lorenzo Valley Water District was evacuated. Next slide. The district's board of directors have held 4 emergency meetings to receive system updates, assess conditions, and to take actions. The board made sure that we had cooperation with CAL FIRE. They made sure that we had emergency water conservation measures in place, and they approved emergency spending to restore water facilities as quickly as possible with emergency repairs, additional temporary staffing, and engineering consultants. Next slide. District staff worked very closely with CAL FIRE and the Boulder Creek Fire Protection District and Ben Lomond and Felton Fire Districts. District personnel were in constant contact with firefighters to assist in their response. They maintained communications with our staff to ensure that water was where the fire was. We monitored CAL FIRE and we diverted water from areas that were not on fire to areas that were on fire. Our main goal working with the fire districts was to keep the Highway 9 corridor charged with water and pressure. We were very successful in doing that. At no time did we believe that we lost fire flow or pressure along Highway 9 from Felton to North Boulder Creek up by the Mountain Store area. They also did come in and put portable tanks by fire hydrants just in case. So you probably didn't see these because you weren't up in the valley. You're evacuated. These portable tanks were placed all over the place up in Boulder Creek. Next slide. Our water connection statistics. Currently, as of today, we have 3,197 connections under a do not drink, do not boil order that we'll talk a lot more. Your water quality specialist, Nate Gillespie, will address those concerns. We have 354 connections without water. Those connections have damaged distribution system components such as mains or water storage tanks. Water is projected to be restored by September 12th, 2020 to all of those 354 connections without water. We may have a connection, an individual connection here or there in the fire burn areas that may be isolated from the main line. Some of the older systems, some of the service lines are not out in front of the houses. They're on different zones. But if you don't have water, you should contact the district so we know. And we can do investigation to why you do not have water. Next slide, please. Areas without water. James, would you like to address the areas that are not in water? You're muted. James, you're muted.
Okay, so I'll start with West Park Drive. So everything west of Blackstone on West Park Drive will be out of water. That's part of our Lion Zone. And that continues over to Highway 236 north or west of Masood's Lodge, which is just outside of town across from Hazel. And all that out there is out of water at this time on the Lion Zone. We also have the South Reservoir Zone, which runs from Sweetwater Lane on Alba and comes down into Clear Creek there in Brookdale behind the lodge. And then we have an out of waters on Alta Via running from our old domestic tank site over to Monin Way. And there's a handful of homes on Monin Way also out of water. Blackstone Terrace is back in water as of last night. And we have some out of waters on Riverside Grove, in the Riverside Grove area on Stewart and Creek. Most of those are burned houses in that area. And I do believe that is the out of waters that we have, unless I'm missing anything.
Thank you. And we have our projected restoration dates. We hope to have everybody back in water by September 12th at the latest. Next slide, please. Major damage that the district received was from our supply lines, our raw water supply lines from Foreman, Peavine, Sweetwater, and Clear Creeks. There is 7.5 miles of raw water supply line that was destroyed by the fire. The photo you're looking at is part of the cross-country line that those were pole supports and the pipe ran on those pole supports. You can see a fitting in that photo where it was melted off of the pipe. It will be challenging to restore these pipes. The district down the road will be looking at the limited access, the time frame to replace, the type of material, damaged trees and landslide. There are a tremendous amount of trees in the watershed that were damaged by fire. In fact, we had to remove a considerable amount of trees around our three major reservoirs that were impacted by fire in order for safety of the construction crews to move back in. We'll have environmental concerns, and we'll have cost concerns, and then constructability. These pipelines were all put in by hand labor. Materials were airlifted in by helicopter. CCC crews worked with district staff to sink poles by hand. It was a five-year project to do that 7.5 miles of raw water supply line. Next slide. As we move into water quality, I'll ask Nate Gillespie, our water quality and systems specialist, to give you the overview on water quality. Nate.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. Some of the Santa Rosa Valley Water District's service areas depressurized in the recent fires. And some structures within those depressurized areas had burned. So when a large portion of a water system depressurizes, contamination can enter the distribution system, just kind of like a vacuum. So contamination can include bacteria, it can include nitrates, and it can include organic chemicals. Next slide. So we know from past urban and forest interface areas where wildfires have occurred that the city of Santa Rosa and Paradise Water Systems found organic chemical contamination following a wildfire damaging infrastructure. Benzene was was found in high concentrations in both of these fire-affected systems that experienced a loss of pressure. The Department of Water Resources believes that benzene and other organic chemicals can be created by the burning of plastic pipes, along with other water system components and structures. And they can be sucked into the distribution main lines when the system loses pressure. Next slide.
Can we go back to that slide just for a minute, please? The picture that you're seeing is a piece of 10-inch HDPE pipe on fire. That was found as soon as the district staff were able to get back into our three reservoir sites. That was the pipeline that connected our three tanks. The pipe itself is burning and just burning back and wicking back. Next slide.
So why is there a do not drink, do not boil water in place? So as a precaution, due to the widespread depressurization, the district consulted right away with our regulatory agency, the State Water Resources Control Board, Division of Drinking Water, and they advised us to issue a do not drink, do not boil notice to the affected areas. Next slide. So I just want to talk a little bit about the water quality process. So we currently do not have any evidence that bacteria, nitrates, benzene, or any other harmful organic contaminants are present in the San Lorenzo Valley Water District system. In consultation with the State Water Resources Control Board, Division of Drinking Water, SLVWD has begun a sampling program to determine if any service areas are affected by harmful contaminants. We've got a very robust sample site selection that we've been working with our regulatory agency on. Next slide. Water quality sampling. So the San Lorenzo Valley Water District is currently collecting samples for bacteria, nitrates, organic chemicals, and other constituents from representative areas of the distribution system, and we expect the results of all these samples by early next week. Sample results, as soon as they're approved by the State Water Resources Control Board, Division of Drinking Water, will be posted on our website. I know that it's taken a while to get information up there, but it takes some time for labs to turn around samples. We are expediting the sample analyses at our contracts lab, but all sample results have to go through the lab's quality assurance and quality control process and be deemed as valid before we get issued the lab report. So we are turning around these lab reports as fast as we can, and we appreciate your patience when waiting for the results. Next slide. How long will the do not drink order last? It's unknown right now. As I've told some people that have called to ask me that question, this is gonna be a marathon, not a sprint. So if bacteria, nitrates, benzene, or other harmful contaminants are found and detected in the drinking water, State Water Resources Control Board, Division of Drinking Water, and the Water District will take actions to inform customers right away and advise them of what they should do to stay safe and how to best avoid exposure to identified contamination. We still don't yet have a definite timeline for lifting the do not drink notice. Again, we're going to let all of our data make our decisions on that. We're not making any decisions without a scrutiny of all data received. And we've got to have multiple sample dates and sample points agree with each other before we can consider lifting the do not drink, do not boil notice. Some parts of the distribution system may be lifted earlier than other parts of the system that were less damaged by the fire. Next slide.
Before we, as we finish up this slide, we can ask questions, and I've asked the district council to facilitate the questioning portion from you all. Gina?
Okay, great, thanks, Rick. Yes, so first of all, let me just ask that if you have put a question in the Q&A or the chat, it is possible that the panelists will see your question and address it during their presentation. But it's also appreciated if you raise your hand to ask your question directly to the presenters so that they can respond that way. It's possible that not everybody has seen all of the questions that are going into the Q&A in the chat. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start calling on folks who have their hands raised in the order that I see them. And you could feel free to direct your question to a particular staff member or the staff member that can best answer it will take it on. But please, at this point, try to address your questions to the district manager's presentation and to the water quality presentation. We've still got some other topics to cover, and there'll be further opportunities for questions. Okay, so the first hand I see is Mr. Joe, and I apologize if I misstate your name, but Joe Cucciara, please go ahead. We cannot hear you, Joe.
You're muted, Joe.
Hi, this is Joe Cucciara, and I'm the former chairman of the Santa Cruz County Board of Supervisors. And I'd like to understand how it's even possible in the year 2020, after a rate increase that tripled our rates, that we're using plastic pipe for major supply in our water district.
Well, Joe, go ahead. You still have a part of your question? Joe,
I'll let you answer. I ask more, but I mean, this is unconscionable. And I've talked to many of the state the Emergency Operations Center officials, and everybody is flabbergasted that we are faced with this kind of a threat. And I understand, you know, the attempt here is to make a happy presentation, but there's some fundamental serious questions about the management of the district and how it is that we are faced with such a catastrophic situation when we have been, you know, our rates have been heavily increased and the district has been, you know, uniformly supported. And, you know, why is this even happening?
Joe, it is a great question. It's just that what we want to address today is getting, informing our customers and answering questions about getting people back in water and lifting the new do not boil. We will be answering those questions, Joe. A lot of people probably have the same. We worked together back in many of storms, as I recall.
Yeah, we had five presidentially declared disasters in my district for the 8 years I was on the board.
Correct.
And I led the National Association of Counties negotiations on the Stafford Act, which is what we're operating under right now. A lot of that language I wrote.
Can I just add about the HTPE that was burned and that was in our system is 25 to 30 years old or plus the stuff that did get burned and melted. It's not new stuff that we have put in the 20th century, as you stated. So just take that into consideration.
James, I'm very aware of that, but we have been funding improvements in this district and our rates have gone nothing but up. My water bill now exceeds my utility bill from PG&E. the rates for water in this district are extraordinary, and for that, we ought to have extraordinary facilities and services.
Okay, Joe, we will address those questions, but this is just not the time to get into the
questions on rebuilding. You're right, Rick. This is the number one issue that everyone is asking. It's the number one question, and the preparation today should have had a response other than we'll deal with it later.
Well, no, this is an operational meeting. Those discussions will be at board level, not at staff level on operations. We're having our questions that we're getting have to do with when will we be back in water and when will we be able to drink the water. I'm not trying to sidestep your question. We're definitely going to have that discussion, but just not today.
On the question of the water quality, it's unconscionable that we still are in a wait and see period for having any data on the water quality results. I mean, if your contract lab isn't servicing you, get another damn lab. I mean, your original notices said by no later than the end of the week, we were going to have water quality response as to what the data was. We have none, and it's a critical issue because a lot of the contaminants that are suspected, you have a do not drink, do not boil order, but you're saying it's okay to shower and wash hair. And a lot of those contaminants are absorbent through the skin. And so we need to know what the conditions are. We have people in this community with compromised immune systems and other health issues, and they need to know if it's safe to shower and wash hair. And your order says it's okay. You know, I've called the district, I've tried to get these answers, and you're saying there's still no data available. Now it's going to be next week, and there's no discussion about the absorption of these contaminants through the skin.
Okay.
We have released the information. Joe, and you probably know better than most, we're dealing with the State Water Resources Control Board, who is the responsible agency. To require us to issue the do not drink order. All of the test results, we are on a 24-hour turnaround, which is about as fast as we can get. Then we have to submit all of that information to the state before we can release it. They review it, and then they allow us to release it. It is a cumbersome process, and it gets irritating that it takes a little bit, but that's the process the state has us follow, and we are following it. We do have a good lab, state certified lab. We are getting 24-hour turnaround. It's just a process, and as you know, it takes a little time.
Well, the way we recovered during the disasters I dealt with was to rock the boat, not accept that it takes a little time. Your original notices and continuing up through yesterday said we were going to have results by today, and also would you please respond to the question about absorption through the skin for shower and hair washing or any kind of, you know, that kind of personal care, because that's a serious issue. These are carcinogens. They are absorbent through the skin.
Okay, Nate, do you want to take the water quality end of that?
Yeah, certainly. So we do have very limited data right now. We do have one data point in the do not drink, do not boil zone. That data is promising. It's showing the absence of benzene, but it's just one data point. We can't draw any conclusions off of that. The district's notice just doesn't address every possible use of water. We've had a lot of questions about showering, watering plants, things like that. And we don't have the data to speculate on whether the water is safe for other uses. So, you know, at this time, we've just recommended to everybody to, you know, just the safest option is to just kind of seek out other sources of water to, bathe with, to, you know, just seek out alternate sources if you're concerned. And
well, your personnel is putting out that it's safe to shower and wash hair. That's a quote from your district personnel. So you're saying that you do not know if it is safe to shower and wash hair and do personal care?
Yeah, we just don't have a ton of data right now. I just can't draw that.
Well, then you ought to put that out in your notice. It's not about not having a ton of data. You ought to say it is unsafe to drink, to boil, or to wash, to shower, or to bathe, or to wash hair. The public needs to know that, and they do not. Your district personnel is saying that it is safe to shower and to wash hair.
Okay. I think there's going to be more questions along these lines. I see a couple of dozen in the queue. So at this point, I'm going to call on Aaron Bergeren, which is the next hand I see up in the queue. And please ask your question.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. So I've just got a few practical questions about sort of information flow. So I'm wondering if the slides from this presentation will be posted, and also the minutes from the other emergency board meetings. The last board minutes are from August 21st.
Yes, this meeting and all past minutes will be posted.
Do you know when?
Holly, can you answer that? Our district secretary.
Yes, board minutes cannot be posted until the board has approved them, but we do have the recordings up. If you go to our website where it says agenda, meetings and minutes, then you will see that there's a link to CT. And most of them are up there now at this point, I do believe, on the YouTube.
Great. My next question is about the sampling program. Does the sampling program cover just the area with the do not drink and do not boil order, or does it cover the whole service area? And will you be releasing any technical information about the sampling program so that people know which areas are being sampled?
Yeah, Aaron. So we actually did sample for VOCs all of the unaffected areas tanks. And that data is posted on our website right now. We did not find any VOCs in our district's other tanks as expected. We did find total trihalomethanes, which are they are routinely found in our distribution system. We monitor trihalomethanes on a quarterly basis. Which is a regulation by the State Water Resources Control Board Division of Drinking Water. So again, that data is on our website. There's a memo that kind of explains the, or attempts to explain the data a little bit better. So I encourage you to please review.
Did you just sample the tanks, or did you sample the supply lines as well?
Just the tanks.
Are there any plans to sample the supply lines?
Not at this time. No, there is not.
Okay. And in terms of the replacement work that needs to be done, are you planning to hire CCC workers again, or will there be an effort to look for local unemployed workers?
We haven't got that far yet, but we would prefer local workers, period.
Awesome. Thanks. That's everything. Thank you.
Okay, and I see that there are almost a couple of dozen hands up still, and there are several segments of the presentation left to go. So what I'm gonna do is, I see hands up through Justin right now. We'll see if we can get through those in the next 15 or 20 minutes or so. Let me do this. We'll go with, take questions until about 3:45. And then move on with other segments of the presentation. There will be more opportunities for questions later on and at the end. Right now, I see a hand from Jessica Mendoza. Please go ahead and ask your question.
Can you hear me?
My name yes, is Jessica we can Mendoza, hear you.
And I'm a resident in the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil area. My questions are centered around sampling. So you have 31 samples so far. Were all of those collected on the same day, August 26th, or are some of those from later dates? Are they all collected from locations within the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil, or does that include the three of tanks outside? And have you done any repeat sampling at locations in the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil area? And how many repeated samples have to come back clear at a given location before you lift the order for that area?
Yeah, so our sampling program has included 11 different sample sites in the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil notification area. Those sample sites are spread out throughout the distribution system, and the Division of Drinking Water wanted us to have a review after three sampling dates data. So that would be 33 samples total in the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil area that we want to review before we go on to our next steps. And
how many days are separated between samples at a given location?
So we have sampled on September 1st, September 2nd, and September 3rd. However, we have collected VOC samples every day since last Friday. So since the 26th, I believe last Friday it was. So as of this afternoon, we have collected a total of 58 samples. Of that 58 samples, we've had results on 8 of those, and only 3 of those have been in the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil area.
I also had one clarifying question. I thought I heard you say earlier that you didn't detect any VOCs in any of the samples outside of the Do Not Drink area, but that conflicts with what you have on your website, which showed one of those tanks actually had some VOCs, although it wasn't attributed to the specific situation related to the fire. Can you clarify that, please?
Yes, you're 100% correct. I do apologize. I did misspeak there. So yeah, we did detect some very low levels of some VOCs we believe related to the paint coating that of our new probation tank at the probation tank sample. Other than that, yeah, VOCs were not detected in any of the other tanks. Thank you for bringing that up.
Okay, thank you. Brad Martin is next in the queue. If you could ask your question, please, Brad.
Hello, you guys hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, I'm just simple, I'm looking for clarification on what is it safe to do with our water? Can we, you know, are we at risk? Can we wash dishes, wash ourselves, clean food prep surfaces?
Yeah, so, you know, again, our notice just doesn't address every possible use of water, what you can and can't do. Again, we just need more data on, you know, if there is contamination out there, and if there is, what chemical is it, and what are its concentrations, and how widespread is it? We just don't have the data right now. So, again, okay. at this time, we want everyone to err on the side of caution, just, you know, seek out alternative sources of water for things like that.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Follow-up question. Should we find contamination in the water supply, does this mean we would need to replace our water heaters once the water is safe?
You know, I just can't speculate on that right now. I believe it would probably depend on, you know, a specific chemical found. I just can't speculate on that right now without any hard data on chemical constituents.
Right. Can that be added to like further agendas? Just something to address?
Yeah, we can certainly do that. And you know, if we detect anything out there, we'll be letting everybody know and posting the lab results, and we will be changing our notice if there is anything detected.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.
So Nate, how many constituents in the VOCs are you sampling for?
So we're using EPA method 524.2, and EPA method 524.2 is a total of 84 volatile organic chemical compounds that are analyzed. So each of those samples we have gives us data on 84 chemical compounds.
Okay. Rob P., you have a question. Please go ahead. Can't hear you,
Rob. I was just trying to unmute. It's a little bit difficult, but can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Great. A couple of questions relating to areas outside the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil region. For instance, Felton, I think I understood correctly that you said that there was no depressurization in those regions and therefore no chance for contamination to get sucked into the system. Correct me if I'm wrong about that. Was there also no heat damage to infrastructure in those zones that could have added contamination?
Yeah, that's correct. So areas outside the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil notification areas did not lose pressure. We have no reason to believe that there would be any contamination in those areas. Thermal degradation was your question. I don't believe we did have areas that were close to the fire in those areas that remain pressurized.
Naturally. Of course, what we really want in those areas is a clean bill of health saying we know there's no contamination coming out of our taps. You mentioned that you tested the water in the tanks. Can we be sure that there is nothing between the tanks and our homes that could also be adding to the problems?
As we maintain positive pressure, that's part of how a water system is designed. The positive pressure is designed to push contamination outward. So as long as we're maintaining pressure, our system remains not vulnerable to contamination.
Great. Last question. We talked a lot about volatile organic compounds, VOCs, but there are also SVOCs, semi-volatile organic compounds that can be toxic. Do you have any plan to test for those?
We're in early discussions with our State Water Resources Control Board regulators on that. And as well as availability of a contracts lab to analyze for SVOCs.
Thank you.
Okay.
Just a couple follow-up to one of Rob's questions about Felton. We do have a small zone in the very high reaches of Felton off Empire Grade that is part of the Do Not Drink. It's a small pressure zone that does not allow water to come back down to the main zones of Felton. And they did have some heat damage to their pipeline, and they are also in a Do Not Drink. 22 connections in Felton, just to clarify.
Okay, for the next individual, I apologize if I don't say your name correctly. Bogdan Marion, please go ahead.
Yes, can you folks hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Great. First, thank you for the information as well as providing the potable water that you're doing in town in the interim. I know that's the state's responsibility to keep us in water, and we kind of appreciate that the water district is stepping up there. Also appreciate the answers to the questions so far. Nate, we had a separate conversation. You answered a number of questions for me, and I appreciate that. I wanted to know what outside agencies the water district is engaging today for mutual assistance in testing water. And, so guidance in what additional contaminations to look for. Because as you know, until we know the state of the water, we're kind of in a holding pattern in terms of our ability to use that water. So if we're not already, are we reaching out to CalWARN or other agencies to kind of help us there?
Nate, there you go.
Yeah, so for right now, it's just San Lorenzo Valley Water District staff that is doing the sampling and coordination with our regulators, the State Water Resources Control Board Division of Drinking Water. At this time, we have not reached out to CalWARN for sampling. We're collecting samples and gathering data and you know, as quick as we can right now.
Okay. My main concern there, I guess, is that, you know, unless the foundation, the testing that we're doing today is, you know, is valid, is accurate, then we might get in a situation where we're kind of pushing out time. And then we find later that there are contaminants that we have to worry about and we have to kind of redo some of this work. So I can't say recommend as just a ratepayer, but I would say urge, sort of ask that we kind of reach out and you know, get as much information, as much help as we can today.
Well, I think we're in compliance and we're working with the state and we are covering all. It's not that we don't have staff or lab to collect additional samples. We are collecting the samples that we need to collect for our system. And correct me if I'm wrong, Nate. We don't have an issue with staffing or labs, do we?
No, not at this time, no.
But it's my impression that we've learned a lot in the last, you know, 3 or so years with the Tubbs fire and the Camp Fire and what have you, and the fallout from that, especially with the same sort of materials in the system. So some of this is kind of new to everyone, it seems.
That's correct, and that's being discussed with with the State Resources Water Control Board and their people that actually work those fires in water quality.
Okay, I appreciate that. My other kind of quick question is, why is it a do not drink order and not a do not use order? If we don't know and we're kind of, you know, it could be totally fine or it could be terribly poisoned, why are we not under a do not use instead?
So the State Water Resources Control Board issued that do not drink, do not boil notice because they don't have evidence of any other contamination right now. We need to test and determine. They believe the do not drink, do not boil is a wide net of precaution, which is why that was issued.
Okay. Are you aware of any sort of insurance impact? I've heard that some providers are not willing to, you know, consider a place inhabitable just based on not having water that you can drink. But maybe that changes if it's water that you just can't use even.
Okay, I don't think the district can speculate about the potential impacts on individual homeowners insurance, but the point is certainly taken.
Okay.
And so at this point, I'm going to go on to the next question from Beth Thomas. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you. A number of my questions have been answered, which is great. But I had a couple to clarify. And one is on the do not drink, do not boil, because I do think it's the communication of it is tricky for people. I think it would be great if we defined it a little better on the social media and the website to let people know, because they're unclear. Do not boil suggests that if you take a shower and you're not boiling the water, that you're not aerosolizing the VOCs or the benzene. It seems like giving people a little more information and saying, you know, it's not clear that this water is safe to use for any instance in which you heat it, or I don't know, some kind of verbiage that helps people understand. The other question I had was, I've noticed there are a number of people in the areas that were not affected who have noted differences in the appearance of their water, which I suspect are due to things like, you know, hot water tanks or issues that are specific to their lines in their home. But can you give us some information on that? And maybe that would be some kind of information to also put on the website and the Facebook so that people are not concerned about the safety of their water in the unaffected areas.
One of the issues too right now is that the district lost our surface water to our surface water treatment plant in Boulder Creek. So the water contrast has changed to well water, which is much more higher in minerals and harder, and it may have even some air in it as it's pumped up from the Zion Quail Hollow area. And people realize that, and they notice that very quickly on a change of water quality sources. So that may be part of it as well. I don't believe we have any issues from heat, you know, from the fire to our water. I think it's more of a change of sources that we're predominantly well water up now in the San Lorenzo Valley in the north reaches and in downtown Boulder Creek, which is usually a blend of surface and well water this time of year.
That would be great information to probably add to the website and social media. And the one quick question is, you mentioned that that you did come up with the probation tank having some VOCs that were of some concern. Is that something that people need to worry about, or is that something that the levels are, or the types of VOCs are not ones that people need to be concerned about? Because I'm sure that information will be out there in the community as well.
Yeah, so on the memo that was posted on the website that has the probation tank VOC detections on it, you'll see a table that has the VOC detected. And on the column next to that is the State Water Resources Control Board MCL, or maximum contaminant level allowable of that. MCLs are health-based standards. And these VOC levels detected in probation tank were well under those state established maximum contaminant levels.
Okay. And how long do you expect that you'll see those in that tank?
I can't speculate on that right now. I think it would take, repeated testing.
Okay, great. Well, listen, I appreciate all that you have done and how quickly you've moved to mitigate the damage, especially in the areas that were affected by the fire. And I think all communication, more communication is better with respect to the community's concerns and making sure that people are understanding what to do and not to do with the water in the do not drink, do not boil areas. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Next up is Lance, and I apologize, sir, your last name, Musian. I'm just gonna use your first name, sir. Lance, please go ahead.
Yeah, so I was wondering about the emergency intertie system that was, put together over many years to address these types of emergencies, and whether it has any impact on addressing the contamination issue in Boulder Creek.
Yes, we are using the emergency intertie right now between SLV Water Felton and SLV North. We are bringing some water from Felton back into the North system. I don't believe we used the south intertie during the fire. We did put the intertie between Mount Hermon Water and SLV on standby as they were going into the fire, as they evacuated, just in case. But we are using some water, bringing it from Felton to our north system up into Boulder Creek.
Yeah. So does that actually help us with the contamination? Like, are you getting, like, let's say, enough good water from the south and pumping it north to be able to deal with this issue with the contamination?
Well, first, the contamination sampling is precautionary, and we haven't found contamination as of yet in our sampling. So that's kind of a hard question to answer. We believe that, pressurization of our water system, especially along the Highway 9 corridor, and keeping water in our water system, our water in our tanks, is the best defense against any type of contamination.
Okay, so that actually helps you do that by using the intertie? Is that
sure? Sure, it keeps water in our tanks.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Okay, and Rick, we're past the 3:45 time mark that I suggested. And there's still some other presentations to give.
Sure.
I suggest moving forward with that, and then we can come back and continue with the questions.
Sure. We can move on with the presentation to the next slide. That would be appreciative. Okay, like we did kind of say, that we do have between the County of Santa Cruz and the District and Office of Emergency Services, we are providing drinking water Currently, we have drinking water available at the district's operations building located at 13057 Highway 9, right in downtown Boulder Creek. Not hard to find. We have barricades out in the street. Right now, we are limiting 2 cases of water per day until we figure out how much water we need. And we could up that if we find we have a surplus of water. We have also had customer service staff delivering bottled water to folks that aren't able to get into Boulder Creek. We've had our staff, and we're available to do that on a limited basis. If you can't get bottled water to your home or can't pick it up, please call or email our office, and we'll have our customer service staff come up and drop some water off to you. Next slide. Damage. As you can see, all of our 7.5 miles of district wall, raw water supply lines were destroyed by fire. Some of this is speculated by the heat maps that our fire consultants have provided with us. We are still putting eyes on the ground up on the watershed, but we believe from the heat maps that all 7.5 miles of the district's raw water supply lines were destroyed. Our surface water treatment plant, where this water is taken to for treatment, was shut offline before the fire reached the supply lines to protect the treatment plant. We saw on daily or hourly satellite heat maps that the fire was coming down the Ben Lomond Empire Grade Mountain, and we shut the treatment plants off to protect so we would not get this water into our treatment plants. So we know our treatment plants are in good shape water quality wise. You know, currently our water supply is being pumped from the district's groundwater wells located in Ben Lomond. That's on the Quail Hollow area over by the Quail Hollow School. And then over in our Olympia area, which is directly behind the Ziani Fire Station. Emergency intertie with our Felton system, questioned earlier, is operational, supplying water from Fall Creek through the district's Felton Kirby Water Treatment Plant up into the San Lorenzo Valley. Next slide. Over 50% of the district's water storage is located in Boulder Creek, right at the surface water treatment plant. It comes out of the plant and goes in storage for disinfection and distribution. The transmission water mains between the large tanks, 4.5 million gallons total, was destroyed by the fire draining those tanks. Construction crews are in the process of installing new piping, which that piping between the tanks is being reinstalled right now in steel for fire protection. And the tanks are scheduled to be back in service by September 12, 2020. Not only were those raw water supplies destroyed, but the raw water operational turbidity monitoring and water pressure centralizing chamber that's up at our intake at Foreman Creek, that's what the photo you see, was destroyed. Right in front of that tank, there was a building that housed all of our turbidity equipment, which monitors the creek for the amount of turbidity in the creek, and our settling chamber that removes sediment. That structure you see, cement structure, had a roof where you could go up into the building. That was destroyed. And there's also heat damage to the concrete structure. Next slide. Repairs are underway. Material procurement was slow in the beginning, and now materials are arriving. Several areas require the replacement of water tanks due to fire damage. I know you're probably looking at that picture and say, hey, that's HDPE tanks. We're putting the same material back. This is being done to expedite the return of water supply and potability to water. Even so, these tanks are being replaced. We will review the type of material, and this is seen as a temporary fix until permanent engineering and discussion can determine what type of material we're going to put back. This is the quickest way to get our customers back in water. Next slide. Repairs are difficult, and this is why we're using these poly tanks that you see, due to the steep topography and the lack of access. The fire impacted high reaches of the district. You can see in this picture, the area, these are the Blackstone tanks. They're located up on a sandstone embankment. The only way we can get to these tanks is to basically shimmy up that pipe and go up a set of carved-in stairs into the sandstone. To maintain gravity pressure, facilities are located on the higher reaches. They can't be down lower than the homes. For gravity, we need pressure, and water pressure is delivered through elevation. You know, fire burned down the Ben Lomond Mountain reaching these facilities. Thank goodness in this neighborhood, the fire came down to our facilities at the top of the ridge, but did not damage any of the homes. This tank, the Blackstone Terrace, required a crane to place the new tanks and remove the old tanks. Next slide. Damage summary. James, you're back on. Do we have volume? He had some technical difficulties. Doesn't appear that he has volume. The damage summary, this will be posted to our website, a much more detailed list, but these are our bullet points. 7.5 miles of raw water supply line, that's those sources we talked about, that run across the Ben Lomond Mountain Empire Grade across Boulder Creek. The treated water lines between three major tanks, that's where we lost our 50% storage. The Foreman Creek Turbidity Station, pressure reducing station that you saw in the previous picture. Riverside Grove tank and booster PG&E drops and SCADA control was burnt. I think James is on now. The tank at Riverside Grove is a steel tank. That neighborhood did experience a lot of loss of structures. The Bull Spring raw water line was damaged by fire. That's up on the Empire Grade Mountain. The south reservoir piping from the tanks to the booster pump is a 2,500 lineal foot cross-country line that's located high up off of Alba Road was damaged by fire. The Alta Villa and Monon Way transmission mains were damaged by fire along Alta Villa between Brookdale and Boulder Creek. Eckley Tank area was one of our hardest hit areas up off of West Park, the old Forest Pool area, for those who've been around for a while. Eckley Tank, the tank was damaged, the booster pump, the transmission main from the tank to the pump, the SCADA control, and PG&E drop. They were all received damage or pretty much destroyed. The only positive thing out of that is a small area. I don't believe any of the homes are impacted. Again, this was something that came over the ridge. I think we have something like 12 service connections off that zone. The Blackstone tank and associated plumbing, that was the tank that you saw us lifting in. Those tanks had heat damage and had to be replaced. They are back in water now. The Bull Spring raw water supply line that goes across up off of Empire Grade from Bull Spring experienced damage. We have done some temporary plumbing up in that area to get that zone of 22 homeowners back in water with a do not drink. Foreman, Peavine, Sweetwater, and Clear Creek intakes all have heat damage to the concrete structure and to the wood diversion dams and screenage. Next slide. Other damage, 200 water meters. We did lose some equipment that was in a storage yard, two trailer mounted air compressors, a 45 kW generator, standby pumps, lawnmower, three sampling stations, and a construction box. Next slide. Recovery replacement costs. The district is still assessing damage and estimating costs associated with rebuilding the water system. Our back of the napkin estimations with our large surface water intake lines, it appears that we're approaching the $10 million mark in damage. Next slide. Watershed, the Ben Lomond Mountain. I'll ask our watershed planner, Carly, to take this slide.
Hello, everyone. So I actually just got back from hiking a majority of the 5 mile pipeline area with CAL FIRE and the county and our forester. as assumed, it looks like a majority of the 1,600 acres that we own on the Ben Lomond mountainside were burned. A majority of the pipe as well is gone or significantly damaged, and as well as the intakes, as Rick mentioned previously. It's really great that we were able to get out the CAL FIRE representative for the Watershed Emergency Response Team. They will be putting together a report and calling out our system and our land specifically, which will open us up to more funding from the state and with the county. From there, we'll work with the county to figure out the damage to the watershed and where we can prioritize restoration. And we'll also be hopefully working more with CAL FIRE's watershed response team in the Felton area as well. We were only able to cover the Ben Lomond mountainside this time around, but we will be taking them out and supplying all the mapping and infrastructure that we've put together for them. We were also developing a district-wide fire management plan with a consultant. Unfortunately, that draft was due to come out in September, and we had this emergency occur. So we're actually switching gears and going to be taking that plan to more of a post-burn recovery plan, as well as doing some fire management for future defensible space and et cetera. The other project we were working on was a grant through CAL FIRE known as CFIP. That was a grant that was going to help us put together a forest management plan along with doing some implementation of that plan. Unfortunately now with the damage, we're switching over and starting out with just a forage management plan through that grant. And then next year we'll hopefully be able to do some more implementation. But otherwise right now it is kind of, we're just working with the county directly and we'll hopefully have some funding available to start doing some restoration soon.
Do we want to take questions on the watershed while we're here, Gina?
Well, the questions have been queued up, most of them from the prior discussions. So I don't think if we start taking questions again, they will be focused on this topic. So at this time, I suggest just going to the end and then we'll go back, circle back to the remaining questions.
Okay, next slide. The surface water supply, approximately 50% of the district's water is surface water. When we have summer stream flows drop off, well water is used to supplement water supply. In the winter, wells are shut down, allowing for recharge to rest and ensure the district does not overpump aquifers. And it winds up to be a 50-50 split. Emergency restoration of the Foreman Creek surface water intake is moving forward. We know from past years that Foreman Creek, once we get normal rainfall, once we get into like a 2 or 3 rainfall event, Foreman Creek can supply most of the district's water supply, allowing us to turn the wells off to rest and recharge. So right now we are moving forward with a temporary repairs to get water from Foreman Creek into our treatment plant to start being able to take surface water again. Next slide. The finance will be presented by our finance manager, Stephanie Hill. Are you there, Stephanie?
I'm here. The district currently has approximately $3 million in reserves to help finance the normal operation and the start of the emergency repairs. This should be plenty to help get us through these next few months. The district is currently working with FEMA and Cal OES for emergency funding for the repairs to our infrastructure damage. As always, we'll continue to try and find any other possible grant funding as well to help pay for these projects. We've been in discussions with multiple institutes that are ready once we get the FEMA allocation to be able to get us a bridge loan to start funding the major aspects of the infrastructure. And we'll continue to work with our insurance company for any of the facilities and equipment that were covered due to the fire damage. At this point, it's unknown if any additional recovery rates will be needed. A lot of this is going to be hinged on getting, you know, good estimates as to how much it's going to cost, what we think FEMA and insurance are going to be covering. From there, we'll be able to have a better idea as to the financial road ahead. Next slide. On the customer service side, if you're concerned if your home is in a do not drink, do not boil area, but are looking for confirmation, contact customer service with your address, email if you can't email by phone, and they'll pull up and be able to look up what pressure zone you're in and give you confirmation if you are or are not in one of those areas. As we've said, you know, the district is waiting for more tests before we know the potential for long-term use. In the meantime, the district has suspended all late fees at least through the month of September. We want to make sure our customers are having time to repopulate. Obviously, this was a very devastating event, and give people a little bit of time to get settled back in. If people did have their homes destroyed, the district does have a catastrophic event policy in place. So we have been getting people, letting us know. We've gone out in the field and confirmed ourselves. So we're trying our hardest to get any of those people that experienced this loss out of our billing system so they're not getting bills. But in general, all other customers will continue to receive regular bills. Bills for the Boulder Creek area may be slightly delayed just because we were in the process of reading this area when the event occurred. Payment processing also has been delayed just due to the mail. So if you mailed in a check a while ago and haven't seen it clear yet, give us a few more days. Today was the first day we got mail delivered back to the office. We hope to have all of that processed by next week. And if anyone has questions or concerns, you know, customer service staff are there to help answer some of your questions.
Next slide. So that was our presentation, and we're going to the question portion. We do have quite a few folks who's joined us, and we do have quite a few questions. And for those who have submitted questions, if we don't get through all the questions, we will take those questions and combine them and try to answer those on our website. We've done that successfully in the past, but we're gonna try to answer as many questions from the folks that have their hands up. With that, I'll turn it back over to Gina.
Okay, thank you, Rick. Next up, we have Leah Holden, who's been waiting patiently. Thank you, Leah.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. I wanted to know if there's a time frame associated with or a contaminant level associated with considering treatment system between the source and the user and the funding for that. And in addition to that, what can a homeowner or a renter do to ensure adequate filtration of their water if they choose to take action before we know definitively from the district or the state if our water's safe?
Yeah, so in the do not drink and do not boil notice, it does state to please not try to attempt to treat or filter the water by yourself. So I would defer to the notice on that. We just can't give guidance as far as treating the water between.
I understand that that's the case right now, mm-hmm. but is there a time frame or a contamination level sort of a threshold for when these things are going to be considered or perhaps implemented by the water district or the state?
Yeah, we would have to just get more data and confer with the state, you know, as far as that goes. And, you know, I just can't give a timeline on that for right now.
Okay, fair enough.
Okay, thank you. Next up is Patrick Cerucci, please.
Yeah, I have a couple of questions. Are we replacing the lines on top of the ground, or are we going to bury them this time? And will they be plastic again, or steel, or what?
All that has not been determined yet on moving forward on the permanent replacement. There'll be discussion on that. There'll be engineering data, and we'll be discussing replacement, permanent replacement with FEMA.
Okay, that's a good fair answer. The homes that are affected, how do I find that? I've got a daughter on Creek Court area, and is that area past Boulder Creek and past Bear Creek Road, is it of concern? Are they fed with this other water line?
James, are you gonna?
Yes, the homes out in the Riverside Grove area, Creek Court, Creek Drive, Stewart. There was quite a few homes lost up on Stewart. I'm not too sure about if any were lost on Creek. I know the Pinecrest area above there was hit pretty hard. But yes, all of that area out there is in the DND DMB.
Okay.
And we do have an active map that we just put all the addresses on. I was just reviewing it right now, and there may be some addresses missing, so don't misinterpret if you are surrounded by the red dots. You're more than likely affected the same way with the DND DMB. But the map will be online if it is not already today.
Okay.
And you can always contact CAL FIRE, who's doing the official assessments. If you have an address, you can contact CAL FIRE, and perhaps maybe they'll give you some information, or at least steer you to the right place on structure damage.
Okay. That ends my question.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next up, we have Dorian Liston. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. So I wanted to follow up again on that point that was raised just a minute ago. So it sounded like, you know, when James was speaking, everyone recognizes that the infrastructure up on the hillside is a little bit out of date. In fact, I think James said it was 30 years, maybe out of date, right? And it seems like the plans we've heard are all describing, you know, systems that are similarly out of date in terms of the materials and workmanship and things. Is there a long-term plan? I mean, is there anybody who's really kind of considering? I think the supervisor who spoke first said, you know, everybody needs to consider what the end game would be if you could build the best system. And it seems like this might be a time to, you know, to put that budget together and see what FEMA might be able to deliver. Right? Is there sort of a end game of that sort in that works?
We agree. I, you know, definitely agree with you on that. There's just a lot of concerns that we don't want to get into today. It's not just, you know, building of the pipe, but there's environmental, there's access. You know, the Benlowin Mountain is very pristine, solid redwood forest, very difficult. It's a walk path. A lot of environmental concerns. It was all hand labor the first time we installed it due to the fact of the environmental concerns. All that will be looked at this next go around. And it is our desire, strong desire, that whatever we put back is fire resistant or fire.
Okay, so it'll be like maybe a couple budgets, like, you know, what you would have in a perfect world sort of budget, what you can put together to get the job done to get, you know, water back to your ratepayers budget, right? I mean, are you considering a tiered sort of all proposal?
All that has to be looked into and decided and will be discussed at board level.
Yep.
On, you know, but we want to put it back to protect it, that's for sure. And we'll see what's available. It's not an easy process. It'll be a time-consuming process, and there'll be a lot of people involved in that.
Or just to extend on that, so when the pipeline first went in, I mean, it was a very wooded area, very hard, limited access. Environmental was very heavy. You weren't allowed to cut redwoods at all, pretty much. You're not allowed to remove things. And speaking with CAL FIRE now, their big thing is build it for the next fire.
Yeah, that makes sense, you know, with urban interface fires being kind of trending, right?
Right.
I think that makes sense. So let's change gears just a minute. I wanted to thank Nate, actually, for his aggressive sampling policy, right? And in working so closely with the State Water Resources Board. Let me ask you, Nate, will the aggressive sampling be continued as the water sources change when the system stabilizes and like when things go back to surface water?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, as I said earlier, this is a marathon. It's not a sprint. So yeah, we intend on sampling from here on in.
Okay, and you'll be working with Stefan and Jonathan basically for months. I imagine.
Yes.
To make sure that everything's safe for us.
We'll be working directly with our State Water Resources Control Board Division of Drinking Water personnel. Yes, correct.
All right, and all of those reports will be posted, right? So we can take a look and discuss amongst ourselves.
That's correct.
All right. Okay. Thanks. That's all I got.
Okay. Thank you for those questions. Oxo Slayer, please go ahead.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you so much. I have just three questions, and I really appreciate this forum. Very helpful. Administrative question. There's a lot of questions going on in the chat, and there's certain people answering them. And can you please clarify whether these are staff or just residents providing their opinions?
Nobody responding to the chat is an employee of the district.
I did see Joel responded with a map link.
Okay, I didn't see that.
I did see that come across my screen, but I don't believe the rest of the management team is responding to any of the chats. I don't think we have time.
No.
Okay, just it might be helpful. There's a lot of information flying through the chat, and I don't know if you're going to do a formal kind of Q&A document or something. That may be helpful. My other question was that you mentioned the filling stations potentially. We just got back in to our homes. I'm not quite staying there yet because I can't shower or use the water. And it sounds like we got another week to get results. Is there a way to implement the filling stations now so that we could get larger volumes of water besides bottled water at our homes for personal use? Or are we gonna wait until the sampling, which is about a week out?
No, my crews are working on a filling station right now. And then I talked with County Environmental Health today and OES, and they are working on water tanker supplies for these filling stations. And I am in the process of building one, and hopefully we can get a second one up and running and put it in a different location than here at our shop. So we'll have two locations. And I plan on having those up and running by hopefully Monday, Tuesday at the latest.
That's great. Thank you so much, James. My last final question is, it sounds like the district is divided into zones, and the testing results may impact different results for different zones. Is there a way to find out what zone my house is in and what test results will be applying to my zone?
Yes, there is. If you just submit a question to us about your address, and we can look up your address and tell you what zone you're in.
Great. Thank you so much, everyone.
Also, Oxo, I just wanted to add on to that that last bit. If there's any change in the do not drink, do not boil notice, you will be directly notified.
Okay. Thank you, Nate. Thank you all. That's it.
Okay. Thank you. Tim Mitchell, please go ahead with your question.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now. Thank you.
So, first of all, the political discourse that occurred at the beginning is not at all helpful. We have a problem. A mistake was made. What I want to know is, what is the timetable? And people have asked this before, for replacing these above ground pipes with steel piping that's located underground. I understand it's going to be a 3 to 5 year process. Could Rick confirm that?
It will be a process. There's no doubt about it. And what we do, whether we go in temporarily first to restore water, or do we move straight into to look at what permanent? We'll be doing both probably simultaneously. But we are looking at putting these facilities back, hardening them against fire. The district does not want to put them back and have to go through this again. we will do what we have to do, but a lot of this is going to determine on what kind of funding. This could be extremely expensive to put back. I don't like to, you know, to interject cost right here, but we do have to be able to pay for it, and it depends on what FEMA will pay and what we can do. We do want to put these back in steel. Putting them back in steel is going to be a project, quite a project, because one of the benefits of HDPE, it's very tough, and it snakes through the redwoods and snakes through the heavily wooded forest. You know, James is right. Now that we had a fire, things are different, but I don't think we're ready to go in there right now and bulldoze all the way across the Empire Grade Mountain to put this pipe back yet without looking at environmental concerns and other types of material. But we will do that. That will be a process that it'll be a public process, very transparent, that you all can be part of.
Thank you. I appreciate everything that you guys are doing. And I want you to know, at least from my perspective, you have my full support as a member of the community. I've been here for 32 years, and we've always had good water quality, good water pressure, and I appreciate the service. And I know several of the people that work with you. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Kat S., please go ahead with your question. Kat S., are you there?
Yes, hold on. Can you cover me?
No.
Okay, sorry about that, I'm at work. So my one question is there any chance that like the VOC contaminations or what is the properties of the water, the chemicals that are in the water and their effects, if they can kind of be simplified for people, like what are the short-term effects and long-term effects, as well as when is the state going to participate in these types of conversations? Because it's not just on you, it's also on them. And I see a lot of people getting frustrated with you guys. And I think that, you know, that's kind of unfair. And so I think that they should also assume responsibility. But I think, you know, like that the no use of the water, I think that is, you know, a reasonable request. I think that making it known the effects of the VOCs that are in the water, short-term and long-term, is a reasonable request. And I do think that the state needs to also be a part of these meetings as well and assume responsibility for the lag in testing. So, I mean, like I work in healthcare, and so to me, it seems kind of ridiculous for it to take this long for results to come back. And I do understand quality control and everything like that, but it still seems kind of unreasonable. So that's pretty much all I have, is just like simplification of what's being presented to us. And, you know, I do think that there does need to be an update with the no use of water. And I think that the state needs to also be a voice or be a part of this to assume responsibility.
Yeah, thanks, Kat. So what I want to say is, you know, VOCs is kind of a blanket term to describe a wide family of chemical, volatile organic chemicals. So as I'd mentioned previously, our method we're using, EPA method 524.2, it identifies 84 unique volatile organic chemicals. So each of those 84 VOCs does have a its own health effects, essentially. So the state regulates any contaminant that has a health effect as an MCL. So the state has established maximum contaminant levels for a lot of VOCs. As far as the health effects, I just can't go into individual compounds of it right now. But if we're detecting a specific VOC or contaminant, we're going to notify everyone as soon as we can, and we're going to be notifying them with what they can best do to limit their exposure to this. So that's just a comment I wanted to get across.
But I mean, it just seems like there was or is a lot of confusion about how to keep yourself safe from possible contamination. And so I don't know. So that would be like really sad for me if it does come up in a negative and not in a positive situation, and people have been using the water in unprohibited, uses, and, then may later on suffer side effects. And it's like you mentioned, we use the EPA method 524.2. Well, I mean, you may know what that is, but I don't know that I don't know what that is. So, I mean, it would be nice to know what that is, So, I mean, just to educate, it never hurts to educate people as to what these things are.
Yeah. So I can go into that a little bit. So EPA method 524.2 is a essential method describing every bit of the analytical process of a sample for VOCs. It's down to what type of collection vessel you must use. It's down to what how to collect the sample. It's down to preservative, to transporting to the lab, to the actual sophisticated lab analysis, and what quality control checks are required for that method. So that's, not to get into, it's a gas chromatography mass spec analysis is the instrumentation used on that. I'm sure, that's kind of the extent of EPA method 524.2 that people would be interested in. But anyway, that's just a little bit of that method.
Okay. And so would you guys be willing to also put in your bulletin or in your posting, in your notice, that just a blanketed do not use the water until the results from the testing comes back?
Yeah, so that is kind of in our do not drink, do not boil notice. I know, as I've mentioned a couple of times before, it just doesn't address every possible use of water. And, we just can't speculate without the data. We just need more data points. That's all we're at. And I know, it's frustrating that we're in this holding pattern waiting for lab data. But, it'll get to us once it's gone through the validation process at the contract lab.
And, okay. And of course, the safest thing to do always is to use alternative sources of water until more information is available. Kat S., does that answer your question? Can we take the next question?
I mean, yeah, that's fine. I mean, I just don't see how it wouldn't be protecting these guys more from liability by just using a more blanketed term by just not using the water. And then also, I don't think that I received any kind of response as to like the effects of what has been found in the water, or will there be information, a breakdown of what those chemicals are and what the effects will be to us.
Yes, if any contaminant is detected, we will be notifying everybody. We will be revising the notice with the detected contaminant and how to best avoid exposure to that contaminant.
The 440 is not here yet. Okay, I do have to go, I'm sorry. No, it's okay. Fine. You can take the next question.
Thank you.
Sorry.
D. Isaacson, please go ahead. We can't, thank you. I think you're unmuted now.
Who was that for?
Sir, Mr. Isaacson, please go ahead with your question.
Yes, I just have two short questions. How will we be notified when it is safe? Will we be getting an email or something like that?
Yeah, everybody will be notified on our website, email, any form of communication we have with our customers. We will be notifying them.
Okay.
Sorry, go ahead.
A map was mentioned. Where is that located? Is there a link on the on your website?
Yes, there is. Yeah, if you go to the Do Not Drink, Do Not Boil advisory on our website, the map will be located.
Okay. There. Thank you. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you, sir. Ed Carapeza, please go ahead.
Can you guys hear me?
We yes. can now.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm a resident of Brookdale, Huckleberry Island, and I'm just trying to, I understand that, first of all, I want to just say thanks to everybody. You guys are doing a great job putting a face to this as it moves in real time. But getting back to, I think, what you were saying, Rick, about the 9/12 date, that date is for the testing to be received, this next stage, is that correct?
No, that's the date that we hope to have all our temporary repairs made and all of our customers back in water. That does not address the Do Not Drink order.
Okay, so basically we're going to supplement the system with a temporary system until the previous pipeline can be rebuilt. Do we have any idea will the PSI and the pressure and the amount of water that each residence is allowed to use, I would imagine it'd be greatly reduced with this temporary system. Can you address any of that?
Well, it depends in the area. Most of this is going to put back within the size that was damaged. Where you are on Huckleberry Island, you should be in water and you should not be in a Do Not Drink if you're truly on the island.
Okay, that's different. We're in Boulder Creek too, and
if you're in Huckleberry Island in Brookdale, that is off of our Brookdale zone, and you are in a drink area, and you have good flow, good pressure. You should have a water system that's pre-fire impacted.
Okay, that is different than the information that we received through emailing. So, okay,
well, you know, you're right on the fringe, and the fringe is difficult sometimes to isolate. But I know the island well. We ran back from 1982 storms. We connected that into the Brookdale zone because it was damaged. You used to come off of the Highway 9 zone, which would have been different. And maybe because we changed zones for you, it might have not been changed over in our computer. But we did do a change due to storm damage on the island.
Okay, but you're certain at this point that the water to Huckleberry Island is drinkable and usable?
Yes. If you're on the Huckleberry Island, there's a couple of huckleberries. Huckleberry Island off of Pacific Avenue in Brookdale, if you cross the bridge, you cross your new bridge, you are in a drinkable area.
Okay, copy that.
I think that the issue there is, like Rick said, there was a zone boundary change there at one time, and I'm glad that this came up, because this tells us that we have a cleanup to do on a zone boundary there. And thank you for bringing that up, Ed.
No problem, guys. Thanks again for all your great help.
Thank you.
Okay, Lisa Zampogna, please go ahead.
Hello, thank you guys for suffering through all our questions. I have some for me and one for my neighbor. And I wanted to say, Rick, you must have been like 15 when you started working, if you were in 82 doing whatever, the pipes. But so first, I'm one of the 350 homes that still doesn't have water. And I was just wondering, would we expect our quality of water to be worse than what else is going up, even though we don't really know how good our water is for the ones that are in Boulder Creek? I'm in Boulder Creek, Virginia Avenue.
Right. Nate can answer that, because we're not only looking for VOCs, because you are totally out of water and there will be new mainline installed, we will also be looking for bacteria. And I'll let Nate explain that, bringing customers back on who are out of water now.
Yeah, so when zones that have been out of water are being brought back into water, we are moving in the area and collecting a sample, a series of samples for volatile organic contaminants, for bacteria, for nitrates, for general physical characteristics. And we're collecting repeat samples at representative locations as these zones are being brought back into water service. So again, we will be reviewing that data with our State Water Resources Control Board engineers and making decisions on the quality of the water in that zone. Again, just please listen to the do not drink, do not boil notice until notified otherwise.
Okay, and then my neighbor's question is, she's got PEC pipes that she just put in her house. Will she need to replace those pipes if indeed there is contamination in our system?
Well, there with that, the service lines that are PVC could and can be affected the same way as the HDPE and plastic poly tanks that we have. It is still a plastic, so it has the potential to be releasing chemicals when heated up. It depends on if her house was endangered by fire and how hot it got around there. There will need to be testing that she should do.
Okay, and then, so in terms of testing, individual testing, would you expect us to be like getting our own testing, and can you recommend even online what kind of testing we should do for our own homes individually?
I don't have that answer. Nate, do you have an answer for that?
Yeah, if customers are wanting to test their internal plumbing, I do recommend only an ELAP certified lab. That's Environmental Laboratory Accreditation Program certified lab. Any sample submitted to these labs has to undergo strict quality control and quality assurance guidelines. I wouldn't recommend using any unaccredited analytical lab for any samples.
Okay.
Nate, do you think the county would have more information on individual homes on water quality on sampling? We'll check into that and see if there's any other information out there.
That was brought up today at the repopulation meeting with Nathan Salazar from County Health, and he was going to get an answer back, and I have a 5:30 meeting with them again today for repopulation. So I will see if I get any information out of that, and we can go from there.
Right, we just received a message from Sierra Ryan, who works in the resource department, and she says the county does have a list of certified labs. So I would recommend going towards the county for past the water meter.
Okay, thank you, Lisa. Joe Cucciara, please go ahead.
Thank you, Gene, I appreciate that. Rick, I wanna try and confirm what I hope will be some helpful things. Are you going to make it clear that you do not have water quality data that makes it safe for people to use the water for bathing of any kind? I think that's what Kat was trying to get at. Since you don't have the data, Nate has made that clear, you don't have the data yet. Are you going to make an announcement of some kind, either by amending your current order or by another method, to make it clear that you do not have sufficient data to tell the ratepayers, the users of the district, that you do not know if the water is safe for bathing or any kind of personal care?
I'll try to answer that, and Nate, you can jump in. Our notice, our do not drink notice, has to be submitted to the state for approval. And I do not believe that they'll allow us to mention or to say one way or another on bathing. Is that correct, Nate, or am I wrong?
Yeah, that's correct.
So Joe, it's difficult for us to put out information that our regulator won't allow us to put out.
Well, I think you
I think know you'll probably disagree, but
well, I think you can get help with that. And I'm gonna get to that, some places to get some help, because this is back backwards. If you don't know if it's safe, people need to know that. And I think you've had numerous questions from the various participants in this meeting who are trying to find out if you're going to make that known to people, that you do not know if it is safe for bathing and personal use. That's vitally important. There are a lot of immune compromised people and other related health issues. One of your speakers mentioned the fact that the moment you use hot water, you're essentially doing the same thing as boiling water, and you're volatilizing any of the contaminants. And so you need to make that clear, that you do not know if it is safe or not. And I think you can get some help. This is a second thing I'm trying to offer as help. Have you been working with Bruce McPherson, the current 5th District Supervisor, because he was also the statewide elected Secretary of State. He's got a lot of juice at the state. And with the Water Resources Control Board, he would be a vital asset to helping you work through the issues about getting your lab results expedited and issues such as making it clear. If you can't put it in your order, you can sure as heck make a statement on your website that you do not have data to justify one way or the other whether it is safe to use the water for bathing and personal care. Are you working with McPherson or not?
We are working with Supervisor McPherson and talking with him almost on a daily basis. I don't believe we have talked with him on the water quality issue. It's more been updating and working on restoration of our system. I have not personally talked to Bruce about issues relating to water quality.
Well, he can be a vital asset for you for the State Water Resources Control Board, as well as dealing with both the state and FEMA about getting the necessary assistance. And that gets me to a third point that might help. Have you already filed for state and FEMA assistance?
We are in that process with the county, as the county is the lead agency and we are part of that. We are working with that. We are part of that process. I'm not sure the actual paperwork has been filed, but we're working with the county and the county's submitting.
Because what needs to start immediately is that you've got to work with McPherson and you've got to work with Congress members Eshoo and Panetta to start making the arguments for 100% federal and state assistance. Because right now, the way the Stafford Act works for FEMA assistance, it's 75% federal, 25% state, but the 25% state component requires a local share from entities such as yourself. But that can be waived by the federal government, which takes the burden off of the ratepayers. So you've got to get Congress members Eshoo and Panetta, even though Panetta is not wholly our district, in prior disasters, when it was Papa Panetta, he carried the weight of dealing with the feds on the disaster assistance claims. And so Eshoo is primarily Silicon Valley, but she sweeps down and picks up part of us. So you've got to deal with both of them, and you need to start early because they need to start communicating with the state and federal representatives that you want 100% assistance.
I agree. From past disasters, that's what we've done. Good information, though.
And yeah. have you made any contacts with the governors or any federal with Governor Newsom or with federal representatives about getting National Guard and Army Corps of Engineer assistance?
That would be the county that would make that request.
No, you are a separate legal governmental entity. You're going to have your own claim.
You need
to start, because you can get National Guard assistance. One of your staff people, I don't know which one mentioned it, I think it was the guy in charge of the actual field construction, said he was trying to get help with water tankers. In prior disasters, we brought water tanker trucks into the San Lorenzo Valley when all of the pipes had been ripped up out of the ground from the extensive flooding. And we had water tanker trucks in each local town to do the mass filling operations that one of the folks asked a question about. And it was the National Guard that provided that.
I agree with you, Joe, and I was part of all that. This is a different disaster. We have different type of damage. The majority of the district's water system is potable and in good shape. We have worked with Office of Emergency Services, we're working with CAL FIRE, and we're working with the county on the needs of the district. And so far, we haven't had a need to contact the National Guard to bring water in. We're making arrangements for bottled water. We can bring other sources of water in. The majority of our system is in pre-fire conditions, in great shape.
No, I understand that. I'm talking about the no drink, no boil area where you're trying to get a larger quantity of water available for larger fills. I think it was James that mentioned that, and he's right on the money. And so the National Guard can help with that.
That's true.
They've got
county,
the trucks.
County
they've
EOC.
The trucks, and they've got the personnel to man the trucks.
Can we move on, Gene, to the next question? I understand Joe's knowledge is great on, I worked with him on several of the disasters, him and Fred Keeley. I think we need to move on.
Yeah, perhaps this conversation could be taken offline.
Yeah.
Directly with Joe. And we could get the next question from Rory Lutter.
Hi, I have two questions. They're both relatively quick. So the first one is, what is the best case scenario? The tests keep coming back clear. When have you accumulated enough data to say that the do not drink, do not boil notice can be lifted?
So that will be done in conjunction with our State Water Resources Control Board engineers, our regulators. So. We'll be collecting samples and conferring the data. Best case scenario is, we're able to lift the do not drink, do not boil advisory in, wide stretches based on data. We're making all of our decisions based on data and nothing else. And And that will also, again, be done in conjunction with our regulator.
And we're hoping, we're hoping by using our distribution system mapping and showing the state with hydraulics, how our water flows, that we can bring some of our service areas, such as the Highway 9 corridor, and some of the areas that didn't lose pressure back on sooner than these outlining areas that are not going to be back in water until September 12th. So we're hoping to bring some of it back sooner than later. And as soon as we get that information, we will get it out to you.
But you won't venture a guess of, back of the hat, like, is it next week, 2 weeks? Like, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but.
And we don't want to put out a time frame or dates that we're not sure of. That's the last thing I want to do is give bad information out. This meeting is to give you guys what we know, in fact, is factual information. And to be transparent on the information we know. And if we knew it, we would tell you. We don't have a date either. That's one of our questions.
Sure. I guess I figured, there's a number of tests that have already been sent out. If all of them came back clear, is that enough data to say, all right, we're okay. But I appreciate your reluctance to say anything that would certainly be held against you if it came back incorrect. So I appreciate that. And so the next question is, all right, so that some of the tests do come back. I'm obviously not a chemist, but say the boogeyman we're all afraid of, benzene shows up in dangerous quantities. If that happens, does that give us a much longer timeline? Obviously would, but do we have the resources available to us to deal with something? And is it going to be a timeline based on the resources that are available to this water district? Do we imagine we'd have, more or less infinite resources from, state and other agencies that could come in and say, no, we're going to fix this as quickly as we can. And it's not going to be a budgetary question of in terms of the timeline.
Well, to answer your question, right now, this is precautionary. If we were to go into the scenario that you just said, we would have the resources. It wouldn't be a budgetary question. We would have National Guard tankers. We would have running a lot more mainline and doing a lot more. And we would have probably a lot more folks coming in to sample and assist. All of those resources are available, a phone call, email away. They're just not needed yet.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. And I know you'll probably dodge the next question. I totally understand it. But are early indications, are you guys getting any sort of sense that this is likely going to end up closer to the best case or the worst case scenario? I know you probably avoid, speculating, but I'll throw it out there anyway.
Well,
I was going to wonder who.
Due to the fact that we were a few steps ahead of this fire before it got into our watershed, knowing that we had HDP pipe, knowing that we had the potential for contamination, we made the command decisions to shut things down 2 days prior to the fire reaching our facilities. So with that, we really believe that the potential contamination is a lot less than it could have been if we were online when this all happened.
Until we have sampling, we cannot, be comfortable in saying that to drink the water until the state agrees. But we feel and the sampling we've taken to date has not shown any contamination up in the do not drink area.
Well, I appreciate that. I think you guys have cleared up as much ambiguity as you're legally allowed to do. So I really do appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Rory. And I just would like to let the attendees know that there are staff members who have meetings starting in the 5 to 5:30 timeframe. We want to get to all the questions and we don't want to cut anyone off. But if you could please try to streamline your questions, it's certainly appreciated. And Jim Mosier, you're next. Please go ahead.
Yes, thanks for taking all these questions. I appreciate all your hard work. I know you guys are working really, really hard. My question has to do with the watershed. I'm concerned with all the fire. We have all this ash, and some of it's considered to be hazardous. We've been very careful, for example, not using a blower. And I'm worried about contamination of the surface water. When the rains come, are we going to end up having some problems using the surface water? And are there any guidelines about that?
That's something we will be addressing with sampling. You know, right now, Jim, we're not using surface water up in the North Boulder Creek, but it is a concern for Fall Creek. We've discussed that, but Nate, have they came back with a sampling plan or any more discussion about that? We know that, we do believe that no fire retardants were used in this fire, just water drops. That was a concern going into it, but I'll refer to Nate if they've made any comments about surface water.
Sampling plan, no. We just haven't gotten there yet. We're just still kind of trying to deal with the, you know, the disaster that did occur. That will be addressed at a later date. But, you know, I think our plan for, you know, when we get some rain, we're not going to have our surface water treatment plants on while we've got, you know, the first flush, second flush, third flush, and beyond, going down Fall Creek and our surface intakes. There's just, who knows what's up there. And, our treatment plants can't handle the turbidity that the ash is going to generate. So, we plan on letting that water pass and not using our surface water treatment plant to treat any of that water as the first flushes come.
Right. And issues with that could force us into really strict conservation if we're determining through sampling or through turbidity. You know, we know that these first rains, and depending on the type of winter we have, those of us who've lived up here for some time know that we can get 10 inches of rain in 24 hours. That will impact our watershed considerably. And we'll be geared up for that. And we'll take our intakes offline. It's just a question of how soon can we go back online and start restoring water storage.
So we're not using surface water now at all?
Not in Boulder Creek, but we are in Fall Creek and Fell.
So shouldn't we be sampling the Fall Creek water now if we're using surface water, if there's some dangers of contamination?
Nate?
You know, we actually did sample the water treatment plant effluent here at our Kirby Water Treatment Facility, and we did not find any VOCs. And you know, in the surface water treatment plant here, we're using turbidity as our surrogate, and we're just not seeing spikes in turbidity right now going into our treatment plant.
Great, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Justin, please go ahead.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Perfect. Thank you very much. I want to say I really appreciate this forum and the access for people to get in touch with the experts. So thank you. Two quick questions. One, with regard to the downtown district, would there be somebody in your staff who could possibly work with the businesses and with the environmental health, the health inspectors, to identify alternative ways to provide water to our downtown so that the businesses can serve the community in the interim? And second question, regarding pumping all the water from the aquifer, you discussed overpumping of the wells and, in order to supply the water for the district. I'm wondering if that will have any impacts for local privately owned wells.
On your first question, we are working with several of the businesses on the bottled water we have. We've allowed more than the 2 cases per day. We've talked to the food vendors, the hot dog vendor and another resident in Boulder Creek. And we will work with the individual business community. And I don't know what environmental health. I understood that environmental health was scheduling with the businesses, but you know, the district isn't part of that. And you know, the aquifers are large, and many people rely on aquifers for water. We'll monitor our aquifers, and we're gonna work, and by putting this temporary Foreman Creek water line in, we're hoping that we do not have to rely on the wells come this winter, that we can let them rest. So as it is right now, we have a positive outlook that we will not be on the wells, not unless something changes, and always something can change.
Yeah, the only add-in on that is it all depends on what happens with the rainy season and how much contamination comes down with the ash down the mountains.
Right. And we do have capabilities to buy water for to receive water from other water districts. That would be well water as well. And so, you know, we want to get back on surface water to rest the wells.
Okay, I appreciate it. And if maybe we could just meet offline at some, or talk some at some point to kind of direct how we can get water to some of the more higher utilizing water customers than, you know, the hot dog stands and the sure. other ones that you referenced. Justin, it would be beneficial.
If I'm correct, you and I were in a meeting the other night with Bruce McPherson?
Yeah, we absolutely were, and I very much appreciated the opportunity to talk to you. I just want to make sure that I know you're very busy, and I don't know if you're the best person to reach out to. It would be good if we could just get some of the more intensive water-using businesses to, you know, be in contact with you, and I can help facilitate that if it would be helpful.
And like we mentioned the other night, that we're trying to get the Highway 9 corridor, which is the business community, lifted from the do not drink. And we're working with the state on hydraulics, because we've maintained Highway 9 as a pressurized in water throughout this whole event. So we're pushing to get the do not drink lifted on Highway 9, which will be great for the business communities.
No, I appreciate that. And I appreciate just the ability for you to say that in front of everyone, just so that people are getting it straight from the horse's mouth, you know, as opposed to you to me to them.
Sure.
Thank you, Justin. Jessica Mendoza, please go ahead.
I had a follow-up question. I think you had mentioned that 8 results have come back from the samples, but only 4 have been posted. When are the other 2 samples from the do not drink zone going to be posted?
Yeah, Jessica, I'm sorry, it was a little bit difficult to hear your question. Could you repeat it, please?
When will the additional results that have come back be posted?
Yeah, as soon as we've reviewed the lab data with our State Water Resources Control Board engineer, and we get the okay to post the results from the State Water Resources Control Board, we will be posting.
And would it be possible to have the 11 locations that are being sampled posted on your website, and how those map on to the water zones, so we can interpret and read the data and see what is relevant for our area?
I think we could do that. Yeah.
Sure. Nate, we can put that on the active map that Dan just made.
Yeah. No.
We can talk with him, and you give him those points, and then he can put it on that map, and that'll clear it all up. Unfortunately, I have to run. I have to go to a repopulation meeting with Cal Fire and CHP. So thank you all. I'm going to leave this meeting, and I hope you guys all get your questions answered.
Thank you, James.
We'll put
the location, the date, the samples taken.
Yeah, if you put the repeated samples at the same location, rather than by the time the results came in, but the location, that would be helpful too. Yeah.
Just starting to get some good mapping up now from GIS, and we have another engineering firm that's working to do mapping for us at the same time. We realize the importance of those that information.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jessica. Frank Widnick, please go ahead. Frank, we can't hear you yet.
Hi, sorry, can you hear me?
Yes, now we can.
Hi, this is his daughter. I'm just wondering, with all of the uncertainty about, I know that there are a lot of unknowns when it comes to the water and whatnot, but this is kind of going back on a lot of people's questions in terms of why is it a do not drink or do not boil versus a do not use? You know, if people are flushing their toilets right now, or if they are running water, and the water is going through their pipes, is that going to cause more damage later down the line when the water is safe to use again? Do they have to run their sinks for a while so that the bacteria can flow through? You know, or flushing toilets, is that even possible right now? Or is it just people should not use it until we know for sure there is bacteria in it or not?
Nate?
So yeah, flushing toilets is absolutely allowable right now. As far as I believe the question would be drawing in contamination into the home, is that correct?
Yes.
I do suppose that could be a possibility. Again, we don't have data identifying specific contamination right now. So it'd just be hard to speculate, but yes, that would be a possibility.
So, but if there is that unknown, then if we don't know that, is it safe for us to even do that though, if it's unknown?
You know, that's a difficult question to answer. I guess, people are going to be flushing their toilets. So, that water is coming in your pipes.
So should we be trying to get the word out then that people shouldn't be doing that? Or, should we just try not to do that as much as possible and rent porta potties? Is that something that we should be trying to tell people?
Well, and Nate, do you want to handle that? I could jump in here.
Go ahead, Gina.
For a moment. The state does have a really strict regulatory framework for what gets communicated in light of the unknowns that exist right now in the system. And unfortunately, there's no basis for the district to be telling the public, for example, not to flush a toilet. However, that said, for anybody who is concerned, the safest course of action for any type of water use is to use an alternative source of water. But that isn't a message that the district can provide because it doesn't have the basis to say one way or the other.
And we realize it's unfortunate, and we realize that's the information that you all want to hear, and it's very frustrating to us that we can't provide it. I mean, I think we're just going to have to use your best judgment and whatever you feel comfortable with moving forward until we get out of this, and hopefully we can get out of this sooner than later and release the do not drink.
I think a lot of the frustration is just coming from the fact of we're getting these, notifications by saying don't drink or don't boil. But when it comes to flushing toilets or bathing or doing things like that people are still doing, not understanding that if we do in a week find out that this water is contaminated, how much damage does that do to our pipes, to our systems that we're going to have to, if we're going to have to replace that ourselves, or is that, and it sucks if one house does it, but our neighbors don't. And, I guess obviously we don't want to be spreading false rumors or anything, but, for the lucky few that are in this conference right now and understanding that we should try to be taking the best case scenario and not using our water or turning on anything. I mean, I don't know. It's an unfortunate situation. And I think we recognize that. I think it's just understanding that there's a difference between do not use and do not boil or drink.
Agreed. And again, we want to, and we are working as close to this with the state as possible to release as much of these do not boil orders as we can as swiftly as possible. Because we ask these exact same questions and we can't get answers either. They don't know. The science isn't there. This was relatively new to the state with the recent fires in Northern California. And they're still learning. And it's unfortunate that we don't have answers for you.
So is there more that we can do as a community to reach out to the state then and help try to spread the word more? Or is it just a waiting game for us?
I don't know if I can answer that, Nate. I think it's a waiting game. I don't like to call it a game, but I think it's we just need to get through this.
All right. Yeah. Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your question. The frustration is certainly understandable.
Mm-hmm.
Letha with Roaring Camp, please go ahead.
Oops, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hey, so I basically had the same questions. My first question is, you guys were evacuated from Boulder Creek. Are you guys willing to take a shower in your homes?
Unfortunately, that's not a question I can answer.
Yeah,
I don't want to mislead people, and...
So you don't feel safe about doing that?
I'll
be answer that question, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm the district's lawyer, and I have to just ask that staff not talk about their personal sort of risk-based decisions that are made outside of the state regulatory framework. That's not information that I think.
I get you, but it's kind of the same thing that we are all feeling is, if you guys are comfortable to take a shower, then maybe feel a little more comfortable to take a shower. Do you get what people are kind of asking?
Yes, but it'd be irresponsible for me to contrary to the state's guidelines. As district manager, I would request that all of you follow the state's guidelines as best as you can.
I will. I was just curious, and that maybe makes people feel like, anyway, I just had that question. So my other question is, if we install our own water tank at our property, do you have a recommendation or can you recommend a water tank in this situation until you guys are fully repaired?
We cannot recommend. There's a lot of suppliers out there, and there's a lot of small water system information on the internet. There's a lot of potable water. I would just make sure that anything you purchase is approved by the proper governmental agencies for potable water for drinking water. Don't buy something that's not approved for drinking water.
Okay. And you mentioned something about the PVC. So if the water has run through the PVC from the top of my property all the way down and it could be contaminated, it sounds like if I put a tank at the top of the hill, then I probably have to replace that PVC pipe as well if it is indeed contaminated, correct?
Well, it's case by case. I can tell you what we're doing. We're replacing all HDPE pipe or tanks that came in close proximity to fire or by fire damage. We believe the pipeline was impacted by heat. We are not taking a chance, and we are removing, cutting a lot of that pipe out and replacing it. We don't want to take a chance of releasing VOCs if they haven't already been released, and the best way to do that is to remove all as much damaged piping or tanks or facilities that have heat damage.
Okay. And then, I had another question regarding that, but the piping that I did from the panel was my own PVC for some, I forget, I think it went from one pipe to another. So I would be responsible for that PVC. I know you have your own PVC. And then the second question is, my water is running, but I do detect a smell. So that probably means not to use it at all.
Well, I guess my first question is, are you a customer of the district?
Yes,
I'm in
Boulder Creek.
Okay, if you have something that's different in odor or something, please call the district and report that and let us come out and check it out. We want to know. You know, our customers are testing the water daily with taste and smell of people that are drinking it outside of the do not drink areas, and you are our best source of information sometimes. So if you have an issue at your house that's different, please call, report that. And we'll send water quality staff out to check that out. We want to know.
Okay. I am in that do not drink, but it does have an odor, definitely.
Okay. Well, we'd like to check that out. It could be just the change of sources from surface water to well water. But if you have an odor, we want to, that's different from before the fire, we would like to check that out.
Okay, I'll give you guys a call tomorrow if anyone will answer the phone.
We will.
Or email or text or something.
Email is the best, but.
Okay, and what's that email address? I know I took notes, but now I forgot who.
You could just do customerservice@ slvwd.com.
All right, I will. I think that's it. Thank you, folks. Thank you for everything.
Okay, thank you, Letha. And Rick, I know we've lost a staff member already, and there may be others. Is there a hard stop coming up at 5:30?
Well, there is for people, but maybe we can salvage this by getting people to submit their questions. And very similar to what we did to the survey, we can collect those questions and see how many are similar questions and try to answer those the best we can. And maybe we'll take those, we can take those questions and to our state regulator and say, these are the questions we're getting, please help us answer. And see if we can get some answers to that. And that's just one thing to think of, because we do have probably a hard stop at 5:30. And a lot of people have been on this call, and I really appreciate to the amount of people who have an interest. And the whole purpose of this was to try to answer questions with good information, because we understand that people are looking for information. So I'd like to get their questions, but we are running out of time.
Okay, so let's get as many as we can through 5:30, and then ask anybody who isn't able to ask to submit to a particular email address for follow-up. Does that sound okay, Rick?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. The next person in the queue is Julie Gumbiner. Please go ahead, Julie.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes,
we can hear you.
So I just would like to summarize my understanding of where we are right now and then ask one quick question. It sounds like because of the warning that the district had and the proactive measures that were taken to prevent really hideous damage to the water infrastructure, there's really a good reason to believe that we have dodged a major bullet in terms of a tremendous amount of contamination or VOC exposure. Would that be a reasonable thing to think?
Yeah, I think that would be a reasonable assumption. However, we can't confirm that without hard data.
I understand that you can't confirm it, and I appreciate your adherence to that. So the next question is, at what point would we have, like, say, a full complement of that first round of testing that would come back and say, so far, we don't see any VOCs, we don't see any contamination. It looks good. What is there a date when that just that first round will be completed and we'll know at least something?
No, we're still waiting on the lab data for that. And, you know, it should be coming in really at any time now. That's just what we're waiting on right now. And I do realize how frustrating it is. A lot of people are waiting for this data, but, we're waiting on it.
And as soon as we get that data, it goes to the state for review. And as soon as they tell us their understanding of the data, we will post that to the website, those lab results, the actual lab results.
So my final understanding and takeaway from this, which I do appreciate so much, is that this order was issued really as the result of a state mandate, and that it's an abundance of caution. And we as individual property owners are at our own discretion about how much exposure to these potential contaminants we're willing to risk. Is that accurate?
Well, if I could just, first of all, everybody is certainly encouraged to follow and should follow the notice to its letter for safety. And if individuals want to do more beyond what the notice says to protect themselves, that's certainly encouraged as well.
Mm-hmm. But would you feel that it's premature at this point for us to go out as as individuals and buy, say, water storage tanks and to engage the services of a water company to, you know, truck in water? Do you feel that that would be premature at this point, or that, you know, we can kind of get by for the next couple of days and we'll have a little bit more data to go on?
That's what I would recommend. That I would recommend that you do not go out and purchase a lot of equipment. This is precautionary. We have not seen, although we have had damage in the higher reaches, but we have not seen any indication yet that we have widespread contamination. I would wait, give us the week, and start getting some data out before you do that. And if for some reason there is contamination, the district will move very swiftly. It's unlikely, but if there is, we will move very swiftly to get a potable water supply and to turn our water back to, you know, the good water that we've had all these years.
Super. Thank you so much. That answered all the questions I think you could probably answer for me right now. Thanks a lot for your diligence and great work.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Julie. Barbara Perna, please go ahead.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
So my question is just, a lot of people texted me saying they couldn't log into the meeting. When will the recorded version be available?
Holly, would you know the answer to that question? You're muted.
I don't know exactly. I can, I will request that we get it posted as soon as possible. They and at CTV, who is facilitating this meeting, that we have a lot of interest, and they've been really good at getting things up as soon as I ask them for it. So okay, it should be.
Right. And Barbara, we're sorry that I understand that we have a 500 attendee limit. And it's great that we exceeded that, but we didn't think we'd exceed the 500 attendee limit. But that was great that we did. So we'll try to get this information up as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Barbara. Alina, please go ahead. Alina, you're still muted.
Hi, there you are. So if we do have VOCs in our system from the burning water pipes, and that can spread through our water pipe network, and these plastic pipes soak up these chemicals like a sponge, and then later when the clean water passes through, they can leach back into our clean drinking water. I'm wondering, are there other intact HDPE pipes in the network that could absorb these VOCs that are not being replaced? And also, I have PECs, and I'm very worried about the plumbing leaching in my house. Can we get funding for per house water testing? And if the water is contaminated, like, we can't personally live in our house with a toddler and risk him turning the tap on and trying to drink it. And so I'm telling you guys, like, we need help from the state to make insurance companies pay out for fair rental value during this time. And I don't know who really we should talk to about that. So I know there's a couple different questions in there, but I just wanted to get them in.
And I'm going to ask Nate to help me out here, but it's my understanding from talking with the state that in the unlikely event of contamination, flushing will remove it, or will remove the contamination. Is that correct, Nate?
You know, again, it's limited data, but it's extensive flushing. I think it's almost determined that replacement is a better mode than flushing. It's just, you know, from my understanding, it's a long flush duration, 200 plus days.
Okay.
Who do we talk to if we are into this issue with it being contaminated, as far as getting a fair rental value?
I can't answer that question right now. It's something that we can definitely look into, but you know, the district's responsibility on most things stop at the water meter. But these are unique, a very unique situation, and we just don't have I don't have the answers to that question right now. It's a question that we'll look into, though. What happens if there is contamination found? We will look into that more.
Well, and Rick, okay. If I may, I think for some of these questions, individual homeowners are going to have to consult with their insurance provider. But I think it's fair to say that if the district can provide any information that would help with documenting insurance claims, that it would be happy to do that if it's the kind of information
that the district provides. That is correct. We will provide all and any information that we can provide.
Okay, and then just any funding or suggestions on how to test our own house, especially people that have plastic pipes?
Again, I don't have that answer, but I do know that the county and FEMA are doing assessments of private property, and there may be something, but I can't answer that question.
All right, thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you, Alina. Rosella, please go ahead. Rosella, are you
okay? Hi, this is Rosella's husband. Hi, two simple questions. We're on Barking Road, off the Two Bar Road, Carter, and just wondering, we were traveling, we were in the car, we didn't hear, is any water available in our area right now?
Two Bar Road should be in water.
Okay, great.
And it is a do not drink area. That's North Boulder Creek off of Highway 9.
Right. Thank you. And then one last question. Is it safe to do laundry? You know, is that?
I'll refer to Nate or I'm water quality.
Yeah. Again, you know, we just don't have data to say if it is safe to do laundry or if it is not safe to do laundry. You know, I know our notice doesn't cover that use, but again, what we would like people to do is just err on the side of caution. You can seek out alternative means to do laundry. We encourage you to do that during this time.
And we encourage you to do that in cold water. I have read that, but we can't get clearances for those that type of release of information to put out.
Thank you for all you're doing. We depend on you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Wendy Brannon, please go ahead. Wendy Brannon, are you there?
Gina, if I may interrupt, as we are getting close to 5:30, could we see if we have any state regulatory agencies or county health or any of the other government entities that may want to speak, maybe in line to speak, that could put out some information maybe? I don't know if we have anybody.
Well, the best way to do that may be to check chat if there are any representatives of government agencies online waiting to speak. Could you please shoot us a quick note through the chat so we know who you are?
And while we wait for that, this is Stephanie Hill. Any customers that have their questions, they can send them to customer service. That way I have multiple staff that can help consolidate all of those into one forum for Rick. And also, if anyone has questions or if they want to make sure the district has the best email linked to your account on file, please feel free to email customerservice@slvwd.com with your address or your account number, and we will go ahead and make sure that that email address is linked to your account.
Mm-hmm. Very important that we have a way to communicate. You're muted, Gina.
It looks like I have not seen any responses indicating that there are regulators online, and I think we're starting to lose attendees. Do you want to take one more question and
sure.
then?
And then we can wrap up.
Sounds good. Okay, Rick Kuhn, please go ahead.
You're muted, Rick.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Sure. I'm on a private line. I'm a rentee in Ben Lomond, and we're within a mile of the fire. Do you think it would be important for us to get our line tested? There's no damage in the system, but I don't know if it might have gotten hot.
You said that you're on a private water source?
Yes, it's a spring in Ben Lomond.
A spring? I'd recommend that you contact County Environmental Health. They would probably be able to direct you. They deal with, you know, small water systems and other than, the potable water, other potable water systems. They would have some pretty good information probably for you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I think that's...
If we could get people to submit their questions, you know, through email, customerservice@slvwd.com, we will do our best to answer. We do feel the frustration in not getting the answers. I feel the same way. I live in this community, lived in this community for a long time. Most of our staff is part of this community. And we want you to have the information that you want and need. And we want to get this water restored back to, you know, potable water. We have a great water quality in the San Lorenzo Valley Water District. All of our water comes from the San Lorenzo Valley. We're fortunate with the water we have, and we want to return that quality to our pre-fire quality. So please be patient. Send us your emails with your questions. Again, we are delivering or having bottled water at our operations building in Boulder Creek. And if you can't get down to get bottled water, please reach out to our customer service staff and we'll get you water. I know it's tough. A lot of people just repopulated. Ask for you to be patient and we will get through this as swiftly as possible. That's about all I have. Gina, and not unless anybody else, Nate or anybody else, wants any closing remarks. I thank everybody for attending. It's much appreciated.